are the rapture generation. But we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. In other words, the coming of the Lord, this is where we are going to meet Him in the air. For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And that we, talking about us, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, sir, we're caught up in the air. Did you notice there that the voice of the archangel with the trump of God? Revelations 4:1. Revelations 4:1. So you see, my dear people, it's time to pack our bags. It's time to pack our bags. Now, if we go back to the time frame here, we are at the very end of the sixth day. We are 5,992. Add 7 years to that, we're over. You see? It can happen any time. It can happen any time. Well, I've heard people say, yes, but the Bible says that the gospel's got to be preached to the ends of the earth. Doesn't it? Does it say that? Yes. What do you think the 144,000 evangelists are going to do? They're going to preach the gospel to those that's left. Mm. You better believe it. You better believe it. So it can happen any time, my dear people. So it's time to pack our bags. Hallelujah. You know, the Lord says in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16, verses 2 and 3, this is where Jesus was talking to the religious people. He was talking to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all of the religious people. So they had come to talk to Him. They said, verse 1, the Pharisees also with the Sadducees came and desired Him that He would show them a sign from heaven. And He answered and said unto them, when it is evening, ye say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. Huh? You know, I never will forget when I first moved over here. Nobody ever talks about nothing but the weather. I say, how are you? Well, it's going to rain. Huh? I know. My dear people, next time I say that, well, don't you say to them, but the sky is red. Yeah. But the sky is red. Lord, we're going to make up a little track. But the sky is red. You see? Verse 3. And in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky, but can ye not discern the signs of the times? Can ye not discern the signs of the times? My dear people, all you got to do to discern the signs of the times is turn on the 6 o'clock news. You don't even have to walk out the door. Huh? Turn on the 6 o'clock news. That's all you got to do to discern the times. You know what? Even the people in the world know it's coming to an end. I briefly, because I never had the chance to look at TV, but I briefly was looking at this environmental summit going on in Brazil. And they're all saying, well, we're not going to be here in 20 years. If somebody don't do something, somebody don't sign something, spend some money, do something. Even they're saying that. Because, my dear people, the world is in a chaos, is it not?
Yes.
It is an absolute chaos. I've never seen anything like it. Well, I'm going to give you another sign here. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, and I should say another word from the Lord. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24. How many of you know that when you want to know what's kind of going on in the world, or that has gone on, or that's going to go on, look at Israel.
Yeah.
Look at Israel. Huh? I love to minister about Israel. I have ministered about Israel for a long time. But look at Israel. You don't realize that Israel is virtually the center of the universe? Huh? You realize that Israel's on the news more than anything else? And even the news media and the world don't know why they're always on there. You see? Of course, we do, don't we? And the Antichrist knows. You see? Well, just because it's the center of the universe. But anyhow, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, beginning in verse 32. This is where Jesus is talking, and he's beginning to speak a parable. You know, Jesus talked in parables. Now, he talks in parables so that people in the world don't understand him, but we understand him, don't we? Jesus said, now learn a parable of the fig tree. Fig tree. Now, how many of you know that the fig tree represents Israel? It always has represented Israel. If you would go to Israel to this very day and order a breakfast or a dinner, you'd have some fig leaves or figs on the plate. Just like the eagle represents, for instance, is America. Or the lion represents Great Britain. The fig tree has always been representative of Israel. So, it's talking about the fig tree here. And it says, now learn a parable of the fig tree. In other words, of Israel. When his branch is yet tender, and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. In other words, what verse 32 is talking about there, my dear people, is the rebirth or the restoration of the nation of Israel. You see? The rebirth or the restoration of Israel. How many of you know there was no Israel prior to May the 14th, 1948, all the way back to 608 B.C.? There was no nation of Israel. All the way back to 608 B.C. until May the 14th, 1948. Hallelujah. Do you know how I remember that date so easy? May 14th. Amen? Hallelujah. It's my birthday. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. So anyhow, he says, in other words, when Israel is putting forth this branch, in other words, when it is restored, or a nation, verse 33, so likewise ye, when ye shall see these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Hallelujah. So what the Lord is saying is, this generation shall not pass. What generation? The generation that witnesses the restoration of Israel. The generation that witnesses the restoration of Israel. When was Israel restored? May 14th, 1948. Now, how many of you know how long a generation is in the Bible? It's 40 years. 40 years. It was restored May 14th, 1948. 40 years. We're past due. My dear people. So there's another word from the Lord. You see, because my dear people, we are the first and the only generation to witness the restoration of Israel. And then we read in the Luke's Gospel, chapter 21. Luke's Gospel, chapter 21. Beginning in verse 25, Luke's Gospel 21, verse 25, Word of God says, and there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, talking about signs of the last days. And there shall be signs in the moon, in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth, distress of nations. Now, how many of you know that all the nations are in distress? They are really in distress today. With perplexity, the seas and the waves roaring. Men's hearts failing them for fear. You know, I've actually seen that happen just in the last year or so. Do you remember in Russia when they, I'll never forget because I happened to see this on the news, when they closed everybody's bank account? And people were having heart attacks from fear. That's the exact words they used. Men's hearts were failing them for fear. That's the exact words they used. But anyhow, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. verse 28. And when these things begin to come to pass, he didn't say when they come to pass, he says when they begin. Begin. Then, my dear people, they've already began. They've already began. The Lord says, when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. So the Lord is saying, when these things begin, when they begin to look up, when they begin to come to pass, then look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Our Lord Jesus said, when the fig tree buds, look up. When Israel as a nation is restored, look up. My dear people, today's world is in a chaos. We all know it. Today's family is under attack. We have divorces, broken homes, drug abuse, child abuse, incest, unemployment. People are having financial problems the world over. The world over. The world over. It's not this country or that country. It's all countries. They're all having problems. It's out of control. The governments don't know what to do. They can't hire enough policemen. They can't find enough jobs. It doesn't matter where you're at. The world is out of control. Why? Because these things are beginning to come to pass, my dear people. They are beginning to come to pass. Today's church is under attack. You say, well, what means is it under attack? Are they full? Are they all full? No, then they're under attack. They're under attack, my dear people. They even attack each other. Well, don't they? They even attack each other. Man, we're a witness of that, huh? Isn't that true? Hallelujah. My dear people, the body of Christ is under attack. The body of Christ is under attack. I thank God that the Lord has shown us how to pray. I thank God every day I get up. I say, Lord, I thank you, I praise you that you have shown us how to pray. I never forget when he put this scripture key thing in my hand. And we all got the same testimony. The Word of God. He's taught us how to pray. Why, my dear people? Because we're going to come into some perilous times in gross darkness. Gross darkness. Get ready. Get ready. My dear people, our country is under attack. Crime is at an all-time high. People are beginning to hide behind locked doors. They're hiding behind locked doors. You know, I can remember when I was a little kid growing up, we never even locked our door. Huh? Never even thought about it. I don't even know if we had a lock. It was never locked. Huh? We just always went in and out. Didn't make any difference night or day. We just went in and out. Didn't think nothing of it. You know what? You can't even go to the grocery store today or to the greengrocer without locking your door. Huh? Why? Because, my dear people, these things are beginning to come to pass. They are beginning to come to pass. People, sickness and disease is coming upon people. They don't know how to act. They're queued up for a year at a time and get into hospitals. And it's going to get worse. It ain't going to get better. It's going to get worse. Thank God we've learned how to pray. Huh? That's the reason why God is wanting to raise up the body of Christ to teach them how to walk in the gifts of the Spirit, to how to lay hands on the sick and to cast out devils, because if you don't know how, or if you don't know someone that knows how, you're going to be in trouble. You better believe it. Wickedness, sin, lust, perversion, abortion, sexual immorality, murder, rape, theft. My dear people, it's running rampant. And I'm here to tell you, the ministers of God, the men of God, will not get up on the pulpits and preach about sin anymore. They're scared somebody won't put any money in the till. I'm not talking about here, I'm talking about America. I know what I'm talking about. You don't hear him preaching about sin. My dear people, the Lord loves the unsaved. He died for the unsaved. But my dear people, so many today are blinded by Satan. They're blinded by the enemy. You know, the world over, the economies of the world are in jeopardy. I'm going to be ministering about something about the economies. You have no idea what's going on in the economies of the world. I look for a total economic collapse by the middle of next year of the entire world. Yeah. I'm not saying thus saith the Lord, but I'm sure telling you the direction is going. It's, everything, if you notice, is coming into a point of no return. It's like when we were kids, they used to have these pimples or zits or what you call them. You know, what do you call them? Anyhow, you know, the things that just keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And what happens? Man, this thing won't go away. Huh? Until it goes bluey. That's the way the world is going. It's a festering hodgepodge of wickedness and sin and perversion. And my God, we've got to stand up and preach the truth. We've got to stand up and preach the truth. I don't care if they spit on us. Preach it anyway. You better believe it. Time, my dear people, time is so, so short. It's so short. I saw this on the news the other day. AIDS. Do you have any idea? It is getting to crisis levels now. By the year 2000, you say 2000, that's a long time. That's 7.5 years. Ain't very far, is it? 7.5 years. By the year 2000, first of all, 110 million people will have AIDS. That's double the population of this country. By the year 2000, the continent of Africa will be totally depopulated with the AIDS virus. You think the world's not out of control? You see? You say, well, how come that's all going on? Well, that must be the judgment of God. No, it's not. Satan. Satan is taking in his harvest. See, Satan has a harvest too. So, my dear people, we see famines, pestilences. Are you aware that 30 million children starve to death every year? 30 million a year with their little bloated bellies? You see them on the TV? Send in a few pence. They starve to death a year. 30 million the world over. And yet, we turn on the TV and you see the Hollywood stars or the movie stars in their opulence. Yes. Makes you sick. You see, my dear people, things are so out of balance. They're so out of balance. And it's getting, the middle is getting whiter and whiter and whiter. You've got the haves and you've got the have-nots. You've got the rich and you've got the poor. You see, this world is it's just a big mess. Well, my dear people, the people are looking for a way out of worldwide problems, but they got no answers. They have no answers. They look to psychiatrists. They look to doctors. They look to financial consultants. They look to their bankers. They look to the World Bank. They look to the World Health Organization. They look to all of these things. But my dear people, we've got to, as the body of Christ, have got to get their eyes to look at God. We've got to get their eyes to look at God. We've got to bring them back to our Lord Jesus Christ and what He come for. And if we don't do it, nobody's going to do it. Hallelujah. In Luke's Gospel, chapter 17, thank you, Jesus. Beginning in verse 26. Our Lord Jesus said that at the time of His return, it would be like the time of Noah and of Lot, speaking of Sodom and Gomorrah. The Lord said, this is our Lord's word, and He's talking about the last days foretold, and He's saying, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. You see, my dear people, the people out here in the world, the unsaved, the lost, they're out here getting married, drinking, giving in marriage, just like nothing's ever going on. Why? Because they've never heard the truth. They've never heard the truth. Verse 28, likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. And my dear people, Lot represents the righteousness of God. How many of you know that? Lot. All right, let me explain this to you. Sodom and Gomorrah. God would not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah as long as Lot was there. Why? Because Lot was God's man. In other words, he was a child of God. Okay? In other words, he represented the righteousness of God. Okay? So, what I'm saying is, when the rapture of the church comes and the righteousness of God is removed, that's when the tribulation begins. You understand? Okay, that's the reason why our Lord calls us the salt of the earth. We are the salt. We are the preservative. The only reason that the Antichrist is not walking the earth at this very minute is because of the righteousness of God. No, it's not because of the righteousness of any of us. It's because of our Lord Jesus Christ. The righteousness of God. So, but the same day, if you notice, the very same day. It wasn't a week or a month or a year later. It was the very same day. My dear people, get ready to pack your bags. Because when God removes the righteousness of God from this earth, I'm telling you, all hell's going to break loose. All hell's going to break loose. They're not going to know what hit them. They're going to be standing outside the door of the ark, beating on it, beating on it, beating on it, and that rain's going to come down, and they're not going to know what to do. Do you want me to tell you what they're going to do? They're going to look for a man on a white horse. They're going to look for a man on a white horse. But the problem is, the man on the white horse then is not Jesus Christ. The man on the white horse then is the Antichrist. Why is he on a white horse? I'm going to tell you why he's on a white horse. Because he comes to looking like he's going to do good. He's a deceiver. He's going to come to look like he's doing good. But, my dear people, he is a deceiver, you see. But you know what he's going to do? He's going to put this big mess all together. He's going to put this big mess all together. He's going to get the peace agreement signed. He's going to get the people all set free and all these other things. He's going to end the world's problems, this individual. You see? Then they're going to have 3.5 years of peace. You see? Then they're not going to know what's going to hit them. I better slow down. I'm going to take off onto another message. Hallelujah. Amen. So you see, my dear people, Jesus said that at the time of His return, it would be like the time of Noah and of Lot. Times that were scarred by immorality and indifference to God and His Word. Everyone was doing their own thing, just like they're doing now. Hallelujah. Look at, turn with me please to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, my last scripture, chapter 3. Beginning in verse 1. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, beginning in verse 1, it reads like the 6 o'clock news. It reads like the 6 o'clock news. My dear people, I'm here to tell you something tonight. You don't have to read the newspaper no more. Read your Bible. Huh? You don't have to read the newspaper no more. Read your Bible. It'll keep you more up to date. You better believe it. The Word of God says in chapter 1, this know also that in the last days. Now, how many of you know that we're not only in the last days, we are in the very last of the last days. Amen. We are in the last days. Perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. Sound like anybody you know? Verse 3, without natural affection. In other words, the homosexuals, the lesbians. Let's don't call them gay, my dear people. They're not gay. I've cast too many devils out of them, I know. They're not gay. They're sick of themselves. They're sick of themselves. They hate themselves. Let's don't call them gay. To call them what they are. They're homosexual. Truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. My dear people, the churches today turn to religion instead of the power of God. The churches today, people would rather sit in a dead church instead of sitting where the power of God comes down and meets them on their level. That's what that means. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. People see the power of God and they run. You're not supposed to run from it. You're supposed to run to it.
Amen.
So, my dear people, Jesus said that when these things begin to come to pass, when they begin to come to pass, look up, my dear people. Your redemption draweth nigh. My dear people, the prophetic time clock is ticking away. Tick, tick, tick. Will it be tonight? Or will it be tomorrow? Or will it be next week? Next month? Or next year? I'm here to tell you, my dear people, I don't know. But I can tell you this, it's soon.
Yeah.
I tell you this, soon. You see, my dear people, we all have eternal life. Amen?
Amen.
And thank God we're all in this room, we're saved. Because I know each and every one of you. I know each and every one of you that love the Lord. But let's think about those that don't. Because eternal life is eternal hell. Can you imagine what eternal damnation is going to be like? Huh? Lord God. Let alone the 7 years of tribulation that some of these people are going to have to go through. Do you realize they're going to have to be beheaded to be saved?
Yeah.
If they do not take the mark of the beast upon their hand or forehead, they will have to be beheaded. You see, my dear people, it's time to quit playing games. This is life, and it's real. Jesus Christ is talking about real things. The people in the Bible are real, and what's going to happen is real. And he said, when these things begin to come to pass, not when they happen, but when they begin. So, my dear people, it can happen any minute. I would no more than go to bed tonight without being saved than a man in the moon. You better believe it. I'm here to tell you, my dear people, you got a spouse, spend some time with them, love them. You won't have them up there. They'll be our sister. You know that? They'll be our sister. It'll be a different life. So you see, my dear people, we are the most important generation that ever has ever lived in the history of the church. We are the raptured generation. We are the generation that's ushering in the second coming of Jesus Christ. We are living eyewitnesses of the restoration of Israel. My dear people, the fig tree has budded, and Jesus said that this generation would not come to pass away until all things would be fulfilled. And my dear people, they just about fulfilled. Do you realize that?